Thank you, Your Grace, and it's an honour to be here, and thank you all for coming. I can't believe how many people have come out on a Saturday morning. Oh,
turn your power on.
Sorry about that.
There we go. There we go.
Okay. Ooh. Can you turn it down a bit? Thanks. When I left McGill and they were making all these speeches, the thing that they said most often, you have to listen to her laugh. So you just got it full blast. Anyway, I'm really pleased to be able to talk to you. I just brought this because I think it's interesting. This is last Thursday's National Post. And I looked at it and I thought you could hardly believe that this is the case. On the front page it says surgeon preparing to transplant human head. And actually I'm involved a bit in this because I'm involved with trying to stop the shooting of Falun Gong prisoners in China in order to sell their organs to foreigners. It's a really terrible situation. And two of our Canadian politicians have been instrumental in trying to stop that. And then the article continues here. Then here you've got fentanyl scourge seen up close in Vancouver Alley. That's all about drug addiction and pharmaceutical companies and that. The next page, insurers willing to limit scope of genetic testing. You get yourself genetically tested and then you can't get any insurance because the insurance companies don't want you. Canada's looking at passing some legislation to prevent that. Child sex abuse sentencing bill scrapped. That was for people where you can marry a very young girl, but the girl is under the age of consent to sexual intercourse in Canada. So that's another big ethical issue. Anorexic woman has a right to starve herself, court rules. Another issue that we would be get involved with ethical consultations. The compelling lure of the narcissist. What I'm going to talk about this morning is about the cult of intense individualism, which you can wonder whether that has got a narcissistic base. And you can even, this is the same newspaper, this is one edition of one newspaper, and you can even go to the sports pages. Hockey club under fire over stance on transgender teen in billet home. And transgenderism is a huge ethical issue at the moment. They're teaching in schools that you can, that sex doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you're a boy or a girl. What you've got a right to do is choose your gender. And so we've got little boys choosing to be girls and little girls choosing to be boys. And there is a mental condition called gender dysphoria, where there is a genuine mental condition. But what I know the figures from Melbourne, because I've just been back there, and these issues, exactly the same issues are coming up in all the Western democracies. And in 2012, the Royal Melbourne Children's Hospital had one case of a child with gender dysphoria. Last year, it had something like 220 cases. So we have to ask, you know, what is happening to our values, to our culture, to what we're handing on in terms of not just some of the good that we might do. And I think we've got to be very careful not to say this is all bad, because some of the things that we're recognizing are good things. But there's a blindness to the harms that we can cause in doing that. So as you know from my title, today I want to discuss the legalization of euthanasia in Canada. As a prime example of what has happened and is happening to our shared values, because all of those issues that I've just shown you in the newspaper, how we resolve those, how we deal with them, what we say is right and wrong, is going to be informed by what we think are our fundamental, foundational, shared values as a Canadian society. And I do have a Canadian passport, so I still consider myself a Canadian. When I was here, I used to be an Aussie Canadian, and now I'm a Canadian Aussie. I believe that history will see the legalization of euthanasia as the most world-changing decision of the 21st century, and that they will view it with enormous regret. It represents a seismic shift in our foundational values. So how did we get into this situation, and what might we be able to do about it now? And that requires starting from and sketching out a much larger context. So the topics I want to discuss briefly with you, because we've got limited time, are these. Progressive versus conservative value stances. What are the, yes?
Sorry, Dr. Somerville, can you stand to one side?
Is that better?
Yeah.
I'm in the way. Okay. Is it okay for you down there? Okay, thanks a lot for letting me know. That's really good. These are the topics. What is the difference between so-called progressive and conservative values? The importance of stories and language, and you'll see I've got From Killing to Kindness, justifying euthanasia, because unless we know how it's justified, we don't know how to say it's unjustified. The best response to euthanasia, which is palliative care, we need to talk about that. And then generating hope and love, and that requires us to understand the nature of hope and love. So let's start. And we're going to have to go, fairly quickly. I wrote a paper a long time ago that was called The Song of Death, The Lyrics of Euthanasia, The Song of Life, The Lyrics of Hope and Love. And so who are the singers of those two different songs? And research psychologists, and in particular New York University social psychologist Jonathan Haidt and his colleagues, have studied the differences between progressive values adherents and those with more traditional or conservative ones. And their research shows that the interpretation and adoption of six moral value foundations differ between liberals and conservatives. Not all of them, but some of them. The moral foundation of care for people and don't harm them, protect people, that was important to everybody, as was prizing liberty and avoiding oppression. Although it was differently interpreted, liberals interpreted it as egalitarianism and protection of rights, and conservatives saw it as the right to be left alone, particularly by the state. But I think that's more true of the US, and particularly now with what we're dealing with, than it is of Canada. I think Canadian conservatives see it as egalitarianism and protection of the rights of vulnerable groups. In fact, there's a wonderful movement in Canada which I'd like you to all know about. It's called the Vulnerable Person Standard. It's being headed by Professor Catherine Frazee. If any of you know her, she's the leading advocate for rights of people with disabilities in Canada. She herself is seriously disabled. And Dr. Harvey Max Chochinoff from Manitoba, who's a research he's a psychiatrist who specializes in psychiatry of terminally ill and dying people. I had the privilege a week ago yesterday, he and I gave a joint presentation in Sydney, Australia. So we all do get around the world, you know, to do this work, because it's happening everywhere. And so this vulnerable person standard is now trying to limit any further expansion of the present permission of euthanasia in Canada. And as you probably know, the federal government is looking at expanding it. So coming back to what these other people found, everybody supported fairness and rejected cheating, but conservatives had a much stronger attachment to loyalty than liberals and more adamantly rejected betrayal. And conservatives had a much stronger attachment to respect for authority and scorn for subversion. And this is what is really important, I think, that conservatives, unlike liberals, sought and used a sense of sanctity and eschewed degradation. And those are stances that allow humans to bond to form mutually beneficial large cooperative societies. Now, as I've discussed in my book, I've got this new book, it's called Bird on an Ethics Wire, Battles About Values in the Culture Wars. And I believe, and this has been a very contentious idea of mine, that we all need a sense of the sacred, whether or not we're religious. And I've sort of tried to evolve this concept that I call the secular sacred. Now, when I first suggested this, which was probably about 10 years ago, everybody got mad at me. And what happened was that the religious people were very angry. They said I was denigrating the sacred by saying that anybody could have it if they weren't religious. And then all the secular and atheists particularly got absolutely furious with me and said I was trying to impose religion on them. So I was telling my students about this, and one of them got up and said, you know, Professor Somerville, when you've got everyone mad at you, maybe you're onto something important. And if you wanted an example of where I think the secular sacred is operating and why I think we need to be aware of it, because I think we can use it to help people to come more towards our ways of thinking, I think the environmental movement is a prime example of the operation of a secular sacred. You see something that must be not laid waste, that can be irreversibly destroyed, and you feel you've got obligations to hold it on trust for future generations. I also think it's an example of what I would call a secular religion. But you know, it's a lot better if people have got a secular religion than no religion at all, because then you can also persuade them that they've got a lot of the features that we think are important and that we share more than we thought we shared. And that's a very important move. So to come now more to about euthanasia, what we have is that we've got a conflict between respect for individual autonomy and respect for the value of human life. And that's where we're in problems. So what are the characteristics of the progressive values adherents, and how do they contrast with conservative values? Well, first of all, individual autonomy takes priority over other values such as respect for life. But what has happened is that this individual autonomy, it's my life and I've got the right to decide what happens to it, doesn't look at the impact of euthanasia at any other level than the individual one. And as it happens, the strongest case for euthanasia is at the individual level. And once you get them off that, it's not nearly so easy to argue for euthanasia. The problem is, it's also really hard to argue against euthanasia at what you can call the meso or institutional level, that is, what does it do to our hospitals, to the institution of medicine, to the institution of law, because you haven't got a physical reality that you can put in front of a television camera that starts crying and saying, why wouldn't you let me out of this terrible suffering? And we know that we are very visually programmed. If we can't get visual images, it's very much harder to make your case. And so the conservative or traditional view would be looking at the institutional level. What does it mean for hospitals and hospices if you're going to force this on them, as is happening in Quebec? And I'm not quite sure whether that's actually come to that in the other provinces yet, but when the McGill University Teaching Hospital, the big MUHC, McGill University Health Centre, palliative care unit, said we will not do euthanasia in our unit. If the person wants it, they can be transferred somewhere else in the hospital that's willing to accept it. The Minister for Health of Quebec, who is a specialist physician, Gaëtan Barrette, actually got onto the head of the hospital and said, you know, you're at risk of losing your public funding unless you allow this, and you've got to do it in the palliative care unit, and we'll even pass legislation to make you do it if you won't. So, I mean, just terrible, terrible situations. It's somehow been resolved, but I'm going to Montreal on Tuesday, and I haven't yet found out what the resolution, maybe Peter knows. No, but anyway, it was a real mess, and my colleagues who are anti-euthanasia, who are physicians and nurses, were desperately upset about this. And what does it mean for freedom of conscience and freedom of religion, which Peter raised last night? And what will it mean for the institutions of law and medicine? Now, this is a real paradox. In a society that recognizes religion is the main institution carrying the value of respect for life. In a secular society such as Canada and Australia, the two main institutions that carry the value of respect for life, and respect for life has to be implemented at two levels: respect for every individual life and respect for life in society in general. And so law and medicine carry respect for life in society in general. So what is it going to mean for their capacity to do that? That we've now changed the law to say that you can intentionally kill, and required, not even just allowed, but required medicine to do that. That would necessarily damage their value-carrying capacity of respect for life. And at a macro or societal or mega or global level, what does this mean? I had somebody come to me who is from India, and said, you know, India looks a lot at what Canada's doing in human rights, and I'm extremely worried about this because we've got a very aging society in India, and people are very worried about how they're going to cope with that, how they're going to fund it. So what will it mean that Canada suddenly said, well, you know, we'll allow this? And by the way, if you think that it can be contained, just look at the Netherlands and Belgium. And one of the horrors of the Carter case, which is the case where the Supreme Court ratified required allowing euthanasia, is that the court refused to look at the proper evidence. The evidence that was taken in the initial trial court was wrong. And subsequently, the Irish Supreme Court, in exactly the same case as what happened in British Columbia, a woman with Lou Gehrig's amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, who was the wife of the leader of the pro-euthanasia movement in Ireland, they went to court to get euthanasia legalized, a very similar fact pattern to what happened in the Carter case. And so what the Irish court did, because the trial judgment had already been handed down in Carter, so the Irish court got all of the evidence that the Carter trial court used to say that if you legalize euthanasia, there's no danger of slippery slopes. It won't be expanded, it won't be abused. And the Irish Supreme Court came expressly to the conclusion that the evidence was clearly to the contrary, that it will be abused and it will be expanded. Now, the latest thing that's happening in the Netherlands, I mean, they're already, they've got a protocol called the Groningen Protocol, which allows parents who have a newborn baby with disabilities, they can have it euthanized. They have legalized euthanasia for children. Belgium has just done that. I don't know whether they've yet legalized it for people with Alzheimer's, but Belgium has got legislation before it to that effect. And in Holland, one of my colleagues said they're going to allow, well, they're not even going to call it euthanasia. In fact, they don't want to call it euthanasia because they're going to say, well, you can only have euthanasia if you're ill. And these people are not ill at all. They are just as what the, and this is a quote, they are tired of life. And originally they were talking about you had to be over 70. I don't know whether they're still requiring that. But one of the, Michael Cook, the editor of MercatorNet, said, well, it's access to being killed for terminal boredom. And I think that that's probably true. And now, and then, of course, you're looking at all of the issues about what about people, what about advance directives. A lot of people don't realize that under the Quebec legislation, which is not the same as Bill C-14, a substitute decision maker, that is not even the person themselves, can consent to what the Quebec Act calls continuous terminal sedation. And continuous terminal sedation is actually slow euthanasia. It is not palliative sedation, because in the Act itself, it says that the sedation is irreversible. Well, it's not irreversible. You take away sedation and the person wakes up. So what it means is, if you consent to this, you've consented never to be woken up. And a substitute decision maker can do that. And normally you would die of starvation and dehydration. And then a major, major, major issue, which I haven't got time to go into this morning, is what does this mean in terms of saying that suicide is an appropriate response to suffering? And what I can tell you is that in every state of the United States where assisted suicide has been legalized for people who are terminally ill, and in the states it's usually limited to a prognosis of less than 6 months to live, every one of those states, the ordinary, in inverted commas, suicide rate has risen. Oregon, which was the first state to legalize assisted suicide, at the time it was legalized, had the lowest suicide rate in the United States. It now has the second highest suicide rate in the United States. So those are the things we have to think about. So now, the other thing that has not happened is we can't just decide, is this safe now? And originally, everybody who was going around saying, let's have euthanasia, they were saying, well, it's going to be rare. But then when you ask them what they meant by rare, they usually said, well, it'll be like Belgium and the Netherlands. So, okay, you look at Belgium and the Netherlands, and what are their rates of euthanasia? And they're somewhere just under 4%. So if that was the same rate in Canada, that means we'd have somewhere between 8,000 and 9,000 deaths a year by euthanasia. Now, I can tell you about the Quebec statistics for the first 7 months of the Quebec euthanasia program. They've just been released, actually, about 10 days ago. And I might not have the figures exactly right, but overall, it's because I haven't got the document here in front of me. But originally, Gaetan Barrett, our trusty Minister of Health, said there'll be about 100 cases a year. Well, from the 10th of December to the 30th of June, they had 263 cases, which was more than three times the original anticipated rate. And don't forget, this is just new. And as people get used to it, it gets used a lot more. That's what we've seen in the Netherlands and Belgium. Of those cases, 21, that is 8% of the cases, did not comply with the law. And of the 21, 18 were things where they hadn't got the proper second opinion from an independent doctor and things like that. But three of them were actually substantive breaches. Two of them were that it was not at all clear that the person was terminally ill. So there were two people who were probably not terminally ill who were euthanized, which is contrary to the Quebec law, but would not be contrary to, well, it could be, because you've got to have reasonable foreseeability of death under the federal law. And the other case, the problem was that it was not clear that the person was ill at all. Might have been a healthy person. So in 7 months, that's what we've got in Quebec. Now, it did say, with sort of proper concern, that the 21 cases have been referred to the Quebec College of Physicians and Surgeons. So we await what they say. So what I'm getting at here is that we can't just be concerned for whether it's about euthanasia or any of these other values, about what they mean in the immediate present. we've got to think about, and in the case of euthanasia, what, how will our great-great-grandchildren die if we legalize this? If this becomes the norm, if this is the usual way of dying. And I think the best description of it, it's actually in a novel called The Children of Men by P.D. James. I think it's chapter 11. And in it, she describes this dystopic society where people can't have children. So it's our reproductive failures that we're looking at present. And they've got a protocol that when you turn 80 years of age, you are given a kit, and it's called the quietus. But that is quiet us. And you are expected on your 80th birthday to commit suicide. Now, I mean, it's a novel about a future dystopia, and it's exaggerated. But so often our science fiction has become science fact. And we really have to watch this. What is happening in euthanasia is that the real pro-euthanasia advocates want to make this the societal norm. And that's the huge danger. I'm not even sure that at the present we can say it's still an exception, because as we can see with what's happening, it becomes normalized. And I mean, when you can get yourself killed for no reason at all. And one of the features of the progressives in all of the values they're promoting is this, because of the intense individualism, there is a perception of a right on demand to have what I want. So euthanasia is on demand death. Abortion is on demand, I don't want to be pregnant. I'm not against the legalization of all drugs, but the movement is, I want drugs on demand. And so it goes with this intense individualism and rights as individuals. So what I think we've got to do in terms of dealing with this is use our physical ecosystem as a model, point out to people with progressive values, which most of the Greens are, they're the guys also, they're pushing protection of the physical environment, and they're pushing euthanasia and all the other progressive values. And what I've been working on is this concept that we haven't only got a physical ecosystem, we've got a metaphysical ecosystem. You don't have to be religious to believe in it, that any society in which reasonable people would want to live has to have shared core values that are good protective values. And our metaphysical ecosystem is all of those values, principles, attitudes, beliefs, stories that we tell each other to bond into. You can see that that's the base of a religion as well. But that's why we've got to talk about traditional religions and what I'd call secular religions. And to point out to people that atheism is a religion. It's a secular religion, so we're no different if we've got a sacred religion, but they've also regard their values as what I would call secular sacred. So what I'm trying to do there is to get ways that we can connect and not be totally divided, because we're never going to coerce the progressive values people to think differently. However, I think we've got a very good chance of persuading them. And I want to talk a bit later about how I think we can go about doing that. And with respect to euthanasia, what I would recommend is that what we believe is that we should kill the pain and suffering. We have to be adamantly advocates of killing the pain and suffering, but not killing the person with the pain and suffering. And that there's no reason that we can't do that. Okay, so these are some of the other values of the progressive values people. They seek control, and in the case of euthanasia, it's control over death. It's almost, the way I see it is that they're saying, we'll get death before it can get us. And that gives us this illusion of control over death. They're very strong on choice. This is the leitmotif of the progressives. You know, I've got the right to choose. And that's connected to control, because you feel if you can choose, you're in control. They question authority, which is one reason why they're so hostile to religion, because they see religion as exercising authority over them. And I would also urge you, in that regard, not to speak of the sanctity of life, because it's so easy for them to say, and this is actually in the Quebec report, that we used to believe in sanctity of life, but that's when we were a religious society. We're no longer a religious society, therefore that is not a value that can inform public or social policy. I mean, appalling, absolutely appalling, but speak of deep respect for human life, because they can't disagree with that. And that's a value of any society in which someone would want to live. And, you know, great philosophers like Jürgen Habermas and that talk about the value of respect for life and how it's always a foundational value of a society. And very importantly, they reject history, which John Ralston Saul calls human memory, which I think is a wonderful term. And that means they reject tradition. So all of our collective memory, for example, that the Hippocratic Oath, doctors have worked according to that for 2,400 years. And the Hippocratic Oath originally divided the two roles of the medicine man. The medicine man was the person you went to get healing if you were sick, was also the person you went to put a curse on your enemy to kill them. And so the medicine man had the dual role of both healing and killing. And the Hippocratic Oath broke apart those two roles and said, from now on, doctors will only be healers. And that's what the staff of Asclepius represented, healing but not killing. And now we've put those two roles back together. Doctors are going to be healers and curers. And I and my colleague Don Boudreau, he's a physician, and I wrote an article arguing that the two roles are completely incompatible, and that if you're a killer, you can't be a healer. And so we got into, you know, pretty great trouble over that too. But you know, that's okay. We're used to that. That's our job. Now, what this means is that they reject tradition. Is that they're values deconstructionists. They pull apart the values and say, there's the bits, and the bits don't have to go together, and we'll just throw them out. And that stance was accurately described recently by Pope Francis, and he called it adolescent progressivism. And it's a belief that change is always good, or a belief that you need change for the sake of change. And it's often also what can be called utopian totalitarianism. The people who believe this and want to throw out all the traditional values see themselves as, they genuinely see themselves as creating a better world, and is entitled to impose their values, even at great cost to those who disagree with them, in order to achieve what they perceive as a better world. And that attitude brings to mind an old saying in human rights: nowhere are human rights more threatened than when we act purporting to do only good. And the reason for that is that our desire to do good blocks out the harm that we are also doing. And so if you want to understand why the progressives are so adamant that they're not going to allow doctors to have freedom of conscience, that's a cardinal feature of utopian totalitarianism. They want euthanasia. They think everybody's got a right to it if they want it. They want to make sure that they make everybody do it, and therefore they're going to impose this no matter what harm it does to those doctors or those nurses. And I recently gave a full speech on freedom of conscience, actually in Melbourne, Australia. And in the course of preparing that, I came to the conclusion, and this was a very disturbing conclusion, that the progressives are actually welcoming the opposition of people who don't, who believe it's wrong to do euthanasia. And I think they're welcoming it because it gives them an opportunity in the public square to show that they can impose their values. And when those values are imposed, they can say, you see, this is the norm of our society. So it's a, sort of it's a double-edged sword about how to handle that so that you're not giving them that opportunity to say, we will show you that everybody else agrees with it. You're an oddity. I was called a while ago in the editorial pages of Nature, which is the leading scientific journal in the world. They referred to me as Canada's neo-Luddite bioethicist. So that's one of the sort of lesser insults that I get. I get much worse than that, as I'm sure His Grace knows. But you know what I came across? It's a matter of what do we mean by freedom? And again, if you want to know more about what I think about this, it's chapter 2 of Bird on an Ethics Wire. I don't think you've got books, have you, for people here? You have? Oh, okay. Well, the bird will be here. Actually, in Saskatoon on Thursday night, we completely sold out. And we have very angry people that there wasn't a book for them, which, you know, for me was absolutely great. So we took their names and they're going to get books and I'll write them a book plate they can stick in. But anyway, freedom. What's the nature of freedom? I think Nelson Mandela's words are really important. To be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others. And that is what we are currently not doing in Canada with respect to euthanasia and actually respect to, you know, quite a lot of the other of these values. Now, the other thing is that you, when you look at all of the values involved, what you can see is that they're all complementary to each other. And at the most basic level, they're founded on what's called a philosophy of moral relativism. Now, what that means is the people who are moral relatives say there is no objective truth. What is ethical and unethical, right and wrong, is a matter of personal beliefs, wishes, and preferences. And that's why they, and whereas the contrast with traditional values people, if you're a Thomist, you follow Thomas Aquinas, is that you believe there are some ultimate truths. You don't believe that we know all about them at the moment and that we can discover new things about them, but you believe that there are some things that are right and some things that are wrong. And so that's the major basic difference between us. Once, if you are a deontologist, that means a principle-based ethicist, which I am, your first question when you face an ethics issue, like that head transplant in the National Post is, your first question is this inherently wrong, to take a head off someone and put it on someone else? My initial answer is yes, I think it is inherently wrong. Although I wrote an article about it, and I found that if you talked about it as donating a body to a head, it seemed more acceptable than if you talked about it as donating a head to a body. And I thought, but that's exactly the same. And I thought, so then anyway, but I, at the moment, I think it's inherently wrong. If for no other reason, that it's pure experimentation. But it also shows that, you know, that there's no limits to what we think we can are going to be able to do. Now, the statement that I make that probably most infuriates the progressive values people is that I believe we should have a basic, deep respect for the natural. And of course, that means that there are some natural truths. And that makes them absolutely furious because they don't, and they argue that the natural has no moral standing and it doesn't, it's got no moral weight or relevance in deciding about ethics. And I was at Oxford and I was very fortunate to have been invited to Bletchley Park, which is a sort of a high-level think tank, and Richard Dawkins was there. And there were about 30 of us, and it was a big oval table, and Sir Nigel Blomfield was chairing, and he was a proper English gentleman that didn't like conflict, and Richard and I got into a knockdown, drag-out battle, and Richard was at one end of the table, and I was at the other, and Richard said something, and I'd go back at him, and he'd say something, and the people on the sides, which was most of the people, was like watching a tennis match, so going, you know, like this, and... anyway, so Nigel interrupted in a very gentlemanly way. I think we all need a break. And so let's have coffee. Anyway, we got up to leave the table, and one of the people there was Jim Watson, you know, the guy who got the Nobel Prize for DNA. And he walked up behind me and he put his arm around my shoulders. He looked down at me, he's a tall man. And he said, you know, Margot, he said, the problem with you is, he said, you're full of mystical nonsense. And I looked at him and I said, Jim, the problem with you and Richard is you're mystically tone deaf. So, and that's the problem. Anyway, so the euthanasia is part of the culture wars. We've got to, but it's important to understand the values of the progressives, and we can learn from them. They're not all wrong. A lot of their stuff is fine, except when it goes too far. And so that's what I'm on about. Now, I've already mentioned this, the importance of stories and language. Words matter. We find meaning through the stories we share and form to form society, and we buy into those shared stories. And the change in our story from prohibition of intentional killing to allowing euthanasia is a radical one. And so we have to be very careful about how we tell this story. One of the other differences here is that the progressives on the whole believe that the only valid way of knowing is empirically, that is factual research and through science. And I believe that we've got multiple ways of human knowing, at least 8 of them, and that among those multiple ways are what I call examined emotions and intuitions, especially moral intuitions. And now the newest scientific research, much to my joy, is showing that actually I am, because I've never had the evidence to back it up, I've just always thought that. But now the scientific research by research psychologists is showing that indeed our emotions and intuitions influence what we see as ethical or unethical, and that we've got deep structures that it help us to decide about what is ethical and not ethical. And it's not just a matter of logic and this sort of narrow reason. Now, I believe reason is what I call a secondary verification mechanism. And by that, I don't mean that it's secondary in importance. I believe it is secondary chronologically, that we sort of have a gut reaction as to, is this right or wrong? And when you talk about physicians killing their patients, almost everyone has a gut reaction against it. And in fact, they want me to stop using the word killing. And they argue it's not killing. And when you ask them, well, what is it? They say, well, it's, one person said it's VAE. And I said, well, what's VAE? And he said, voluntary act of euthanasia. This is quite a while ago. And he had jumped up in an audience of about 600 doctors that I was lecturing to a few years ago. And I was in Australia at the time doing this. And he screamed out, Margot, will you stop using that word killing? It's not killing, it's VAE. And later in the same presentation, I said, well, if we do this, we should have someone else doing the euthanasia, not doctors. Let's keep it out of medicine, hospitals, nurses, etc. And it's been suggested that the people who should do it should be lawyers because they understand the law and can apply it strictly. And the same guy jumped up in the audience and screamed at me, Margot, are you crazy? You'd have lawyers killing people? But I'll tell you what my recent extension on that is. My recent extension on that story is that we should never, ever, ever approve something that we're not willing to do ourselves. So I suggest training the 9 judges of the Supreme Court of Canada to be the people who carry out euthanasia. So, anyway, language is awfully important. You know, when you call euthanasia the last act of good palliative care, no different from anything else we've ever done, that all sort of, we know, it changes the public's opinion of it. So here's a major example of what has happened in this regard. How did the Song of Life get converted to the Song of Death? And why did that happen? I think the major reason is that we've lost our capacity to be able to find any meaning in suffering. And we used to do that through religion. Now, how we can do that for secular people is a big challenge for us, because we really need to try and do that. And Harvey Chochenoff's work and his book, his new book called Dignity Therapy, is extremely important in giving absolute practical step-by-step instructions in how you can let somebody who's dying, who's not religious, you don't have to be religious to use this, find some meaning. That, because one of the things we know is that they want their memory to go on. They want to leave a legacy. They want other people to see them as having dignity. And how do we do that? But here's a major example of the conversion. Just look at this. This is the front page of the Globe and Mail the morning after the Carter decision, a step towards kindness. And so the Globe and Mail was totally pro-euthanasia, by the way. I was about the only person who could get anything into the Globe and Mail that said euthanasia was wrong. And I used to have people from across the country sending me stuff and saying, Margot, can you ask the Globe to have a look at this? So I'd send off the stuff to the editor whom I knew and try and get, and some of it got in, but not very much. For about every one article that was on anti-euthanasia, there was article after article after article. You know, and that whole Sandra Martin thing because of her husband who died of a brain tumour, who was the famous doctor in Toronto. I mean, that did enormous damage. Now, the Carter case, and this is really important, relied very heavily on the relief of suffering as a major justification for euthanasia. In the trial judgment of the Carter case, the word suffer or suffering appears 212 times. I mean, that's amazing in a court judgment, that the word would be in 212 times. And in the Supreme Court, they endorsed the trial judge's interpretation of the charter rights to life, liberty, and security of the person. I'll just tell you here what they did with the right to life, although probably all of you know about this. The trial judge gave this analysis and the Supreme Court endorsed it. They said that the right to life in Section 7 of the Charter was breached by a total ban on assisted suicide and euthanasia, because if they were not available, you would be forced to commit suicide earlier while you were still able to do it by yourself without assistance. And therefore, if you knew the assistance would be available later on, you could continue living until you sought the assistance. And therefore, having a total ban shortened your life, and that was a breach of the right to life. In other words, the right to life was turned on its head to include the right to death, to a right to an inflicted death. And they also said that living where you knew that you could not get assisted suicide or euthanasia and contemplating future suffering was a form of present suffering, that knowing that you could have those things, that suffering would be relieved. I mean, again, I've written with a research assistant, wonderful research assistant. We did a big article. It was a solicited article for an English, the Oxford Press Medical Law Journal. And we did a constitutional analysis. And with respect to the Supreme Court, because I am a lawyer, They're wrong on this. You know, the other interesting thing, and I just found this out, they didn't just give a normal Supreme Court judgment. They gave a judgment as the court, all of them as the court. And that is a rarely used mechanism, and it's meant to show that this is the strongest possible judgment that they could give, and there were 9 unanimous judges. Now, I've just got a new scientific article, which is very interesting, and what it shows, and this is by mathematicians and statisticians, is that a unanimous judgment is less reliable than one that's got a minority dissent. And the reason for that is that the fact that it's unanimous probably means that they haven't examined all of the arguments that, or, and facts that should have been examined, and therefore that's how they came to unanimity. And therefore, if you've got a lineup for, what's this, the guy at the scene of the murder, and every observer says, yes, that's the guy, that's a less reliable judgment than if some of them disagree. It means they're not considering all the facts. So, I've got to be careful about being too nasty to the Supreme Court of Canada. Although I'm now back in Australia, they could still get me. I want to go very quickly through this. This is important. How did they justify euthanasia? Well, what they did was they had Emeritus Professor Wayne Sumner from Toronto, and he's got this theory called the non-deprivation theory, which is that if your life is terrible, death is a benefit and you're not being deprived of anything good. Therefore, that's a justification for euthanasia. And the Supreme Court's got a huge, big tract of his, the trial court has, I'm not sure whether the Supreme Court repeated the whole thing, but they adopted this argument. The no difference argument, which was that this is just a small variation, that there's no difference between giving adequate pain relief or turning off a respirator and giving euthanasia. That is a failure to understand, first of all, the principle of double effect. You don't give the pain relief to kill the person, you give it to relieve them of pain. And secondly, the research shows that if you relieve pain, the chances are the person will live longer. And also, there's a very interesting research project from, I think it was from the Foothills Hospital in Calgary, and that was that they randomly assigned people who had a terminal illness either immediately to palliative care or to the standard, ordinary medical treatments and later on to palliative care. And of course, everybody assumed that the palliative care guys had died far sooner than the other guys. Guess what happened? The people assigned immediately to palliative care lived on average 4 months longer than those assigned to the other protocol. And probably the reason was that they were better cared for. The people in the palliative care knew what they were doing. They probably had their pain relieved, and we know that unrelieved pain, you can use all your physical resources to try and deal with it. So that's really important. And also, the right to refuse treatment is a right to inviolability, not a right to die. The Supreme Court interpreted it as a right to die and then said, well, it doesn't matter how you die, whether it's by taking away the respirator or giving a lethal injection. The best response to euthanasia, access to good palliative care. They're both sides of this argument dealing with the same question. How do we deal with death in a modern, pluralistic, democratic society such as Canada? In particular, how should we respond to suffering? And the pro-euthanasia answer is a lethal injection, and the anti-euthanasia argument is with hope and love. And the euthanasia debate is not about whether we die. We all die. It's about how we die and whether that matters to individuals, institutions, and societies. So the question becomes for us, how do we generate hope and what does love require? And that raises the issue of access to palliative care, and it's an absolute disgrace that only between 16 and 30% of people who need palliative care in Canada get it. And I know that there's lots of people now become aware of that. It's a pity we didn't become aware of it a lot earlier. And as for pain relief, we now have what's called the Declaration of Montreal, which has been adopted by the World Health Organization, the World Medical Association, and by many of the pain societies. I think the Canadian one's adopted it, the Australian one has. And that is that it is a breach of fundamental human rights for a healthcare professional to unreasonably leave a person in serious pain. I was heavily involved in the drafting this declaration, and I think it's the single most important thing I've done. Because if we can assure people, I hoped that if we could assure people that they wouldn't be left in pain, that we would treat it as a breach of human rights if they were left in pain, that they wouldn't go with euthanasia. Now, that declaration was passed in October 2011 at the International Pain Society meeting in Montreal. And so it's pretty pretty important. Am I going way over time?
No.
It's okay? Yeah, tell me, because I tend to. I've got so much I want to tell you that it's very hard to think what to leave out. One of the interesting things, and something that I think you're going to have to think about, I think it's a very good argument, to Bill C-14 says that you need informed consent to euthanasia. The Quebec Act does not require it, the Canadian Medical Association doesn't require it, and the Supreme Court of Canada didn't require it but implied it because they required the person to be competent. Now, informed consent doctrine requires that you must offer to the person all of the treatment options that would be material to a reasonable patient in the same circumstances, and you must describe the risks, harms, benefits, and potential benefits of each of the treatments, including a refusal of all treatments. So what that means, in my view, is that you cannot get an informed consent to euthanasia unless you have offered fully adequate palliative care, because that's the alternative treatment. There's a new paper out of the Netherlands. It's in Dutch, so all I've got is a small translation of the main points. We're doing an international paper at the moment, a big international group of us who are opposed to euthanasia. And we're using this paper as one of the pieces of evidence. And what it was 40 people, I think it was the Netherlands, or Belgium, who it must be the Netherlands because it's in Dutch. They had requested euthanasia. And they then offered these people really good palliative care. And 38 of them changed their minds when they had really good palliative care. So it's really, really important. Now, generating hope and love. I think that the song of life is an opera and the song of death is a solo role. And the opera requires a wide variety of people and roles, and we have to build the structures that are needed to successfully stage it. And palliative care is the scene setting. And the family used to be the main producers and directors, but with the breakdown of the wider family, other participants are needed. Fear of being a burden and dying alone and in hospital, quote, hooked up by doctors to their machines, are triggers for euthanasia. And the song of death focuses on a suffering individual person who wants euthanasia and their right to choose. And that's exactly, it's absolutely the only thing that we see in the Carter case. And we see the Supreme Court repeating the stories of the people who had terrible deaths, or the stories from their families. And we don't, you know, the trial judge rejected almost all of the witnesses who came in to say there are also good stories that you can have at the end of life. The other thing that was interesting was that it's a while since I did this, but I counted up how many expert witnesses there were on each side, and it was something like 40 pro-euthanasia expert witnesses and 18 anti-euthanasia expert witnesses. So there was an imbalance. And so what we have to ask is supporting suicide hope-generating and loving? And I don't believe that it is. I don't believe it does either of those things. It simply cuts off the opportunity for hope generation and expression of love. And, you know, this idea that we've got a right to suicide, if you really, if you're a competent adult, if you really analyze that, it means that if you've got someone brought into the emergency room who has attempted suicide, if they've got a right to do that, you've got a duty not to treat them. Rights and duty are correlative. So, and we, none of us believe that. We all, every time, you know, it's full action stations. Let's save this young person who's tried to kill themselves. And there, and the, one of the arguments in the Carter case was there's no difference between suicide and assisted suicide. Well, and that suicide was not a crime, and therefore assisting it shouldn't be a crime. But suicide was decriminalized in, I think it was 1972, am I right? Not to take life, but to try to save life, because people were frightened to go to doctors or seek medical help or tell somebody that their kid was suicidal because they thought they'd be charged with a crime because suicide was a crime. And it, suicide is very different. It's an individual, personal act. It's not taking the life by a person who is licensed by the state, and the approval, and the state is approving the taking of life. And the normal role of medicine and the state is to preserve life, not to take it. And so this is part of the difficulty with all of this. I also think that that if we don't see a mystery in death, whatever it might be, then we're not going to see a mystery in life. And then we become, well, we might as well be robots. And, you know, of course, some of the sci-fi literature is that that's what we're going to be. And in fact, that's what the transhumanists, that's another big area that I'm involved in. These guys that are looking forward to what they call our post-human future, when we won't be human at all. And there was an organization founded in Toronto called Better Humans. And in about 2009, they phoned me up, and it happened to be the 1st of April, and they asked me whether I would come and give a speech on the making humans into cyborgs. And I thought it was one of my colleagues playing a joke on me, and they say, oh, you know, Margot, get her, she'll give a speech on anything. And anyway, so... But it turned out they were a genuine society, and that's exactly what they want to do. And now they've expanded and expanded and expanded. At the time, I looked on the internet, and there were a few websites where you could find something about them. But now there's millions of hits on the internet. And so that's exactly what they're after. And I think that we've got to see a mystery in death if we're not going to destroy the mystery in life. Pro-euthanasia people appeal to empathy and compassion. This is the argument that, you know, you love your dog and your dog's suffering, so you take him to the vet and get him euthanized. Why don't you do the same for your mother? Well, the answer is your mother's not a dog. But you see, Professor Peter Singer, the philosopher at Princeton, he believes that there's no valid moral or ethical distinction between a human and an animal. And that's another idea that I'm engaged in. The editor of the Ottawa Citizen asked me to write a column on what did I think was currently the world's most dangerous idea. And my answer was that I thought that thinking that there's nothing special about being human is the world's most dangerous idea. But you can see that fits with a lot of the other things that I've been talking about. I was curious at the time what would my colleagues in the law school at McGill think was the world's most dangerous idea. And I got only one consistent answer. Everybody said the same thing. Does anybody know what they think they might have said? No? They said religion. They said religion is the world's most dangerous idea. Yep. We need to know that. And that's what the law schools are teaching. Which is why I'm going to Alberta Law School on Monday. University of Alberta. So, the nature of hope and love. A reporter once asked me what was the favorite line I'd ever written in all of these thousands, millions of lines I write. And I knew immediately that hope, and this links to what Peter was talking about last night, hope is the oxygen of the human spirit. Without it, our spirit dies. With it, we can overcome even seemingly insurmountable obstacles. Hope is to the human spirit as oxygen is to the human body. Hope requires a sense of connection to the future, a belief that what we do now can have an impact on the future, even if that future does not include us. Hope requires imagination, which is an important human way of knowing in ethics. We can give even terminally ill people mini hopes, things to look forward to. Feelings of a loss of dignity, which is strongly associated with a desire for euthanasia, could be connected with a loss of hope. I no longer have anything valuable to give. I no longer am contributing. I'm just a burden. When you look at the reasons, and there's lots of studies done on this, for asking for euthanasia, loss of dignity, loss, which is loss of independence, that where you have you are no longer a human doing, and it's not enough to be a human being, then that is the major reason for euthanasia. Pain is always about 13 or 14 down on the list of reasons for euthanasia. So there was a presentation given in Toronto recently by Sister Mary Rose Maron, and I was very interested to see, as she described briefly, what her presentation will be. She said, we need to reflect on the role of mentor and wise elder, as well as the call to be witnesses of hope. And she was talking about, the main title was continuing to grow in the second half of life. And so for people who are older and they need a cause to live for, I think that's a really interesting thought about becoming witnesses of hope. And I think our sisters here, that's what you witness to, very much so. And so if we're elders, have we failed to generate hope in younger people, to maintain the conditions that elicit hope? Has the obsession with youth and youthful beauty led us away from fulfilling that role? And another big ethical issue at the moment is modification of the human body, particularly for cosmetic or aesthetic reasons. Now, I love St. Augustine. So, and he's got something to say about hope. He said he's got two beautiful daughters. They're named Anger and Courage. Anger at the way things are, and courage to see that they do not remain as they are. So I think we need to think a lot about hope. And then in relation to love, please help, have I 5 minutes? Okay, what I'll choose to do is I'm going to read to you a blurb that I was asked to write for John Vanier's last book, which was called Our Life Together. And I think he's got an enormous amount to teach us about love and love in practice. And so here's what I said. And when I say people with disabilities, think within that context of dying people and how this applies to euthanasia and palliative care. As I move through Jean Vanier's letters to his and Larch's friends and supporters, increasingly he signs off with, love Jean, the most simple and profound salutation. This book is a love story of a different kind. It shows the extraordinary flourishing of the human spirit that can occur when a certain kind of love, a truly unselfish, non-self-centered love, is made central to ordinary daily life. Jean Vanier's radical counter-contemporary culture message is that we non-disabled people are the losers in refusing to accept disabled people and respecting the unique gifts they have to offer us as individuals and societies. He writes, and I quote, "It's not a question of going out and doing good to them. Rather, receiving the gift of their presence transforms us. This unfashionable belief in the enormous value of what people with disabilities can contribute was summed up for me by a L'Arche assistant, a non-disabled person living in the L'Arche community, who said, 'You have to understand, Margot, we're not martyrs, saints, or heroes. We do this because of the fullness of life it brings us.'" Jean Vanier's letters gently show that among the many gifts that people with disabilities can offer us are lessons in hope, optimism, kindness, empathy, compassion, generosity and hospitality, a sense of humor in its true sense of balance, trust and courage. But as Jean Vanier recognizes, to do that, people with disabilities must be treated justly, given every person's right to the freedom to be themselves and respected as members of our community. That requires us to accept the suffering, weakness, and frailty that we see in them, which means, as Jean Vanier emphasizes, we must first accept those realities in relation to ourselves. Most of us find that an enormous challenge and flee. The ethical tone of a society is not set by how it treats its strongest, most powerful, most privileged members, but by how it treats those who are weakest, most vulnerable, and in need. This book is a testament to an amazing example in the latter respect, and as such deserves to be widely read and deeply contemplated. Jean Vanier's remarkable, uncommon, common humanity shines through these letters. Not everyone will share his Christian tradition, but everyone can learn from him how to enrich themselves, others, and our world through developing, experiencing, and celebrating the, and I quote him, "the gifts of the heart," and putting into practice, again I quote him, "a little sign of love in the world." So we must ask ourselves, what are the gifts of the heart, and what does putting them into practice, a little sign of love in the world, require of us in relating to dying fellow humans? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I don't deserve it, but I love it.
Dr. Somerville, and talking about shared stories, shared values as a community, do you feel that those are shared by all humanity? And if not, what effect does the mobility of population, immigration to different countries, and even the connectedness of the World Wide Web have on those sorts of values for us as a community in Canada?
Well, that's a huge challenge. I mean, that's really where a lot of this is coming from, because we used to be more or less unicultural communities and geographically isolated, and we're no longer either of those things, and that's what makes it so much more difficult to find a shared story. But, and we don't even agree on what we think are the basic human rights. And so the challenge is, you know, to try to manage that in some way that is the least destructive and least conflictual. But I think that at the moment there's a grave danger of fragmentation again, that we've had a quasi collective of the, you know, we talk about globalization, and globalization is a kind of a quasi collective. At the same time as we are often deeply culturally embedded in what we think is right and what we think is wrong, which goes along with that, and it's going to be an enormous challenge what we do about that. I had a speech that I gave quite a long time ago. It was in a series of speeches, and it was called Spacing Out and Spacing In, Searching for the Purple Pink Middle. And you know what? The CBC used to have competitions to guess what my speeches were going to be about. And anyway, what this was about was that the radius of our knowledge had increased so much with, first of all, exploration of outer space and astrophysics and, you know, the Hubble telescope and the space station, everything. And that was all the spacing out. And the spacing in was into deep inner space, which was our genetics and, you know, who we were and where we came from. And so that, and I sort of hypothesized that maybe we are genetically programmed to only be able to relate to a certain limited number of people. And there is some sort of evidence of this by the sociologists and anthropologists, and that maybe, you know, we have a very close inner circle, which is our family, and we have a genetic, well, we should have, it, if at all possible, a genetic bond to them. And I believe the genetic bond is so important because it's the only bond that cannot be voluntarily broken. You can't break it. You are where you who you receive. I call it through whom life was transmitted to us. And so then you've got a sort of a more, you know, close friends and people that you work with or whatever. And then you eventually go out to the limits of what your circles are. And it seems as though we have a comfort level with about 200 people, but once it gets beyond that, we don't feel close. So it's really interesting to think about these secular religions, and within those I include nationalism, sportism. I mean, you go to Australia and 3/4 of the national news or 3/4 of the newspaper, it's all about sport. And that's because sport is Australia's national secular religion. And it's a very pluralistic society. And I think it's being used because it's one way that people can feel that they do agree. You know, they've got their team and they have these symbolic battles. But what we do beyond that, it's hard to relate to humanity as a whole. And yet it's necessary that we see other humans as much more like us than unlike us, no matter what they do. And I think that's probably the base of, you know, what the church teaches, that you love the sinner but hate the sin. So you disagree with something that you think is wrong, but you don't hate the person who believes that. And maybe that's a bonding mechanism. But I've got a lot of questions, but I haven't got a lot of answers. But you know what? We're working towards them. And yesterday in the seminar I gave, I used an old Chinese proverb that says, the bird doesn't sing because it's got an answer. It sings because it has a song. And in it I said, you know, that the writers of the Psalms and poets knew that a song was much more effective than an order. And I think that's also a lesson for us. And that's part of what I had a whole lot in this speech about that, but I just had too much in the speech about what can we do to make what we want to see happen into a song that is so attractive, or we are attractive because we sing that song, that other people want to seek us out. And one of the concepts I'm doing a lot of work on at the moment is something I dreamt up. And at first, you know, everybody said, oh, Margot, you've gone flaky New Age. And what it is, I think we need to refine a sense of amazement, wonder, and awe, and through that, a re-enchantment of the world. And paradoxically, I think the place where we can are most likely to find amazement, wonder, and awe, and to be able to have a lot of people who are progressive values people come with us, is in the new science. I mean, it's an absolute total miracle that four nucleic acids are the base of all life. I mean, that, you know, the billions of different species and plants and animals and us, and we're all made of the same stuff. I mean, it's completely amazing. Completely amazing. Or the Hubble telescope, they pointed it at what they thought was a blank patch of sky, and they found billions of galaxies, not stars, but galaxies. And so I've got this theory, which I was on a television program a while ago, and I got an unexpected question. They said, do you believe in UFOs, unidentified flying objects? Well, you know, it's not usually what you expect. And I thought quickly, and I'd been up in the Northern Territory of Australia, and there were these termite hills, and they were all about 8 feet high, and they were all exactly the same shape, and they were all along the magnetic lines of the Earth. So they were all lined up. I mean, it's an incredible sight. And I thought about the ants that live in them, and I thought, well, for those ants, those termite hills, and maybe their neighbours' termite hills, that's their universe, that's their world. As we're pretty certain that they don't know anything about the Earth as we know it. And they've got their jobs and their social order, and they've got a queen, and they've got the worker ants, and they've got the breeder ants, they've got everything. And so I thought, and it's what I suggested, that we're the ants of the universe, that we know what we can know, but we haven't got the capacity of knowing what's beyond our knowing. And so these little scientific things show us that there's a huge mystery beyond our knowing. I call it the mystery of the unknown, which I think is another way probably of saying you believe in God. I had a 13-year-old boy who asked me straight out in front of 600 kids aged 11 to 18, did I believe in God? And, you know, it's an interesting question in front of a bunch of kids. And so I tried to explain it to them that I think, I told them I didn't believe in a man in the sky with a long white beard. But yes, I believe that there was something much greater than us, and that's what I think we mean by God. And I think we've got to be, open and different in the way we present, so that people can see that we've got, whether it's a peace or a joy or a blessing or whatever it is, that they would like to have too. And that therefore, what we have to use is persuasion and attraction, not, bossiness, and certainly not just pious statements. That just simply won't work. We might as well give up. And I mean, there's this whole new science of epigenetics, which is magic. And our environment changes our genes. I mean, that's extraordinary. Now, there was a question over here. Madam.
Margaret, I'm sorry, it wasn't quite a question. You cleared up all my questions. And so I want to thank you from the bottom of my toes for just your clarity. You have such a gift for belling the cat, as they say, bellies. And I thank you so much for that. There were two points you made that just cleared a lot of the fog. And one was how we are such a visual people today. So we're bombarded by these images on corporate media and television about, you know, these people who, progressives, and thank you, you clarified that for me as well, who talk about, the kindness, all those things, the values that they propose, that we're bombarded with, again, on corporate, you know, on media. The other connection, and thank you, the other thing, that point you made was about the environment. It does include the progressives as well, but care for the environment from Mother Earth does entail as well a sense of the future. And if people don't have that sense of the future, that kind of cripples anyone. So, Mark.
Thank you. Thank you.
very much, Dr. Somerville. That was a terrific presentation. Lots of food for thought. I'm a public servant, and I was in the room when a retired deputy minister, now retired, but when he was active, he was briefing the minister on healthcare costs. And he said, "Minister, the last year of life is the most expensive for healthcare costs. And the introduction of euthanasia will help us contain costs. We think this is a viable public policy to pursue." And I wanted to check in with you. Have you been confronted with that argument? And how do you deal with that argument?
Yeah. Well, what you say, actually, in the last 6 months of life, the average person uses half of their lifetime healthcare costs. And there was a long time ago, there was an article in the New England Journal of Medicine that was called Dealing with Healthcare Costs, Squaring the Slope. And what it was, they tracked how much healthcare you use through your life, and then they showed in the last 6 months that you went down like this, and that slope down was about half of your lifetime healthcare costs. So the goal was to have you squaring the curve. You didn't go down the curve, you went along up here, you're well, and then you go chunk, you know, down. Like the lemmings, you know, the lemmings sort of worked it out. You go over the cliff. And so euthanasia would be a major cost-saving mechanism. But in the beginning, if you raise the issue of euthanasia as a cost-saving mechanism, people who were pro-euthanasia went completely berserk, and I got accused of putting up straw man, I was fear-mongering, I was doing all this sort of stuff. Now it's completely accepted that it's a valid consideration of whether or not you use euthanasia, that it will be cost-saving. It is now in the literature. And the biggest area where it is being discussed is in relation to patients with Alzheimer's disease. And the World Health Organization has given a prediction of how many people in the world will have Alzheimer's by 2040. And it's absolutely huge. And then they do calculations to see whether the various countries' healthcare systems can cope with that. And the answer is no, as it presently stands. And then the issue of euthanasia comes up. Well, wouldn't this be one way to deal with that? So, yep. You know, initially, there's always, the people who are pro-euthanasia always say, this is going to be rare, it's going to be restricted, and as soon as it's legalized, that goes by the wayside. Do you know that Bill 14 is already being challenged in the courts on the basis, not that it's illegal to allow this, but on the basis that it doesn't allow for enough euthanasia? The people who won the Carter case and were so jubilant are absolutely furious with the Trudeau government over this. And fortunately, the Minister of Justice, and it seems a bit the Minister of Health, are at least trying to restrict the damage that legalising euthanasia will do. I mean, I got asked to appear before the Senate committee after Carter, and my first reaction was no, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do anything to help you implement a law. But then all my anti-euthanasia friends said, no, Margot, you've got to go, because now what you've got to do is try and limit the damage. And that's what we're trying to do. This vulnerable person statement is a limiting the damage effort. And it's very good. It's very good. And so what we're hoping is we can prevent advanced directives, we can prevent it being available to children, and we can prevent it from being given just for pure mental illness, no physical illness.
I just wanted to put your thoughts are on the that you can see this as very much a spiritual battle, the humanizing of humans in every way, that there is from the progressives the call to kind of get rid of 90% of the population on planet Earth, for it is better for the planet.
Who would that?
They want to diminish the population of the Earth, for it's bad for the planet, for the environmentalists. So to, in every way, to gain and Singer saying that animals are more important than humans, and just in general that humans are seen not as beings, but as doers, as we just talked about, just being existence as a human is not important. And to for I can see there's a spiritual battle that we are created in God's image and that we are becoming Lord of God's creation, and that is just a very much a spiritual battle.
Well, it is that, and it's a lot of, it is, of course, a spiritual battle, but it's a lot of other things too. It's resources, it's physical, it's beliefs, it's ethics, and spirituality is very important. I think one of the things that palliative care is doing is including pastoral care with palliative care, which is really important. I think that's an extremely important effort. And one of the problems for the people who are pro-euthanasia is that they completely reject any reality of spirituality. And I think that by pointing out to them what they do believe in, we can get them to see that it doesn't have to be called religion, but that they can have a spirituality of their own. And so I think that's what the environment offers us as an example. Their care and thoughts and feelings about the environment. But you know, one of the things I'm most worried about is that kids are not in contact with nature. And I actually believe, this is another one of my controversial beliefs, I believe that we've actually got genes for spirituality, don't panic, Archbishop. I'm not a genetic reductionist, which means that you believe we are simply the expression of our genes and there's nothing else that counts. But what I believe is that we've got these genes, that they have to be what's called imprinted, that is activated by certain spiritual experiences when we're very young. And I'm not making this up, because this is what genetics is showing us. My colleague at McGill, Michael Meaney, is now famous for showing that mother rats who didn't lick their baby rats, the baby rats could never nurture their own young, because the baby rats had genes for nurturing that had to be activated shortly after birth by the licking of the mother rat. And epigenetics actually changes the physical structure of the gene and makes it active. And the way I see those genes is like a radio or a television set. If you haven't got the radio or the television set, you don't know what program or you could listen to or watch. But on the other hand, if you've got them and they're not working, you're just as badly off. So what you need is you need those genes, and you need, if I'm right, okay? I could be totally wrong on this, but if I'm right, and they need to be activated. And I think the activation has to happen at a very young age. And so that's why I think this idea of these parents who say, well, I'm not going to impose any religion on my kid. When he's 20 or 21, he can find out what he wants to be. I think that is absolutely wrong, because what we know about epigenetics is that there is a critical time period during which the gene can be activated. And if you don't have the environmental trigger in that critical period, it shuts down for life. It can never be activated. And I mean, they're just finding out amazing things. I went to a lecture on, do we inherit all our parents' epigenetic changes? And at the moment of conception, all of the epigenetic changes from each of the parents fall off the embryo's genes, and the embryo gets its new epigenetic inheritance. And there's also, I mean, they're doing all sorts of amazing things. I mean, they're doing this in mice, not in humans, but, you know, as my friend Alan Trounson, who's a great geneticist with whom I frequently disagree on ethics matters, he said to me when Dolly was born, you know, the clone sheep, he said, Margot, if you want to know what's going to happen with humans, look at what we're doing in animals now, and we'll be doing it in humans 7 years down the track. And that's largely true. And the other, you know, when I wrote the paper I gave to you today, and I told you that I thought euthanasia was the single biggest ethics issue of the 21st century, I now think it is one of the two biggest issues. And the other one is altering the human germ cell line. We've never been able to do that. That is the genes that are transmitted to every human being from the vast array of ancestors of humans. And we've never been able to change that. And now we can. And what the Archbishop quoted was something, that was what you quoted, Archbishop, from the meeting I was at in the US, that when this wasn't possible, that we thought there was universal agreement among ethicists that we would never, never, never intervene on the human germ cell line. It was described as the common heritage of humankind to be held on trust for all future generations. And now, England's just given permission to do some intervention on it. And I think that's the other major, major issue, because it comes to designing humans. And that raises all sorts of issues like, is that human free if they've been designed in a certain way? Are they equal to the person who designed them? Usually the designer is superior to the design product. Does it make them a product? Does it alter democracy? Because the fundamental pillars of democracy are that we're all free and we're all equal. If you're designed, you're not free and you're not equal. So anyway, is there one more question? And
this is a little more fundamental, or back to some of the earlier stuff you were speaking about in terms of the euthanasia, and it's not contrary to the hope that you were referring to, but can you see, like, in your discussions with the doctors and those who are against euthanasia, and you were talking about with the University being forced to perform this, can you see, or in your discussions, determine or visualize a time when maybe a doctor or a hospital or a group would be forced to do it, and they would absolutely refuse and to be prosecuted under the law, that there would be some kind of social action where all of the nurses and doctors who disagree with euthanasia would basically lay down the tools and say, I'm out. That is, without this type of radical social movement, we're not likely to make much in the way of gains. So, like, those who fought for just labor laws, went on strike. Morgenthaler broke the law, went to prison, but he made himself look like a hero and a martyr. So, you see?
Yes, I get what you're going about. The problem is that with doctors and nurses, it is different from a group of factory workers going on strike, because you might want to do it to make the points that you're making, but there's enormous harm to other innocent people. And so it's very, very difficult to know how to handle that. There is discussion of civil disobedience being required, but I think it would have to be more in the Morgenthaler style, that we have some prominent doctors who decide that, they're going to stand up against this, and if they get sent to jail, then see what happens about that. I don't know. I don't know what will happen. But certainly there's a huge amount of concern, not just within the medical profession, but much more generally about the failure to respect freedom of conscience. I mean, that is fundamental to our society. We base ourselves and pride ourselves that, we don't make people do things that we believe are, or they believe are seriously wrong. So, yeah, difficult issue. Thanks for the question. Yeah, okay, well, my book's a good place. But that's just self-promotion, so don't take that too seriously. But it does deal with all these things. But the other place, and I would recommend it to all of you, is a website called, it's www, of course, mercatornet, mercatornet. And it is excellent. It is run by Catholics, but it doesn't base itself on that. It's based on secular arguments and presentations and facts, and the articles are short, and they're written with the idea of the general, for that they should be easily used by the general public. And then they've got a subsidiary site called BioEdge, and I got the new, and you get a once a week newsletter, which is done by a whole group of, under the same editorship, and it's Michael Cook, who's a Harvard-trained journalist who lives in Australia, who's heading this up. And anyway, a group of really young PhD students in ethics and philosophy, and they write little tiny one or two paragraphs summaries of what has happened that week. Like they would take this newspaper and put a paragraph about each of those topics that I mentioned to you. And it's a very, very, I mean, I use it because it keeps me more up to date than anything else that I can get hold of. And so I really, really recommend that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Pardon?
Can you repeat the website?
Yes, it's Mercator, MERCATORNET, mercatornet.com, C-O-M. And it comes from Mercator, with somebody who mapped the globe. He was a map maker, I believe. And so this is the map maker on the net. Michael will wonder what's happened if he suddenly gets all of you logging into...
Thank you for the awesome and inspiring talk. So my question is, I jumped on, you know, when you said that the best response to the passage of the information law is how is it here, and then that thought of we need to make it so great and joyful that people are drawn to how is it here. So my question is, how much progress has there been in looking at the economics of this kind of system where it's just, it responds to the person who's dying, that the care is there. The kind of a background is, you know, how much is sedation used, for example, with the elderly in nursing homes? And, you know, is that really the appropriate response for somebody who's a little troubled? Shouldn't it be more nursing care, more people, more staff? So, and since you're working with
Okay. Well, there's certainly been a big advance in research on palliative care, and there's lots of good journals, and they've just had the International Palliative Care Conference in Montreal, which is held there every 2 years and attracts about between 2,000 and 3,000 palliative care researchers and practitioners from around the world. And there's been some studies on the cost, and in fact it's cost saving to put people into palliative care rather than to put them into tertiary care hospitals, which is often the alternative. And I'm just trying to think of the rest of your question because something came to mind and now I've forgotten what it was. But
probably have a bias that maybe sometimes pharmaceuticals are used too much.
Oh, okay, that's what, yeah. Okay, as to whether palliative sedation is used too much or drugs are used too much. And yes, that can be the case. And the other big specialty that's really important is gerontology. And there's a lot of research on pharmaceutical use by family physicians in old people, and very often they're not used properly because the metabolic rate of an old person is not the same as of a young person, and all of the research trials on metabolic rates of drug elimination are done on 18 to 25 year old men, and it's not even valid for women. So there's been a big push to get women into the research, and it's certainly not valid for an 85 year old. And on the whole, the figures are something like they found that old people were on between 5 and 11 drugs a day, and that they were just zonked out. And so there's a big new push to try to do something about all of that. There was a situation in England where the National Health Service, which pays for medical care in England, accepted what was called the Liverpool Protocol. I don't know whether any of you know about it, but essentially what it was to put old people on deep sedation. It was like, well, it wasn't palliative sedation because it wasn't indicated as the last resort for relieving awful and unrelievable suffering. Anyway, and what the NHS also did is it gave a bonus to the hospitals for every person that it had that died on the Liverpool Protocol. And so suddenly the hospitals, some of the hospitals had a whole heap of these people. And then there were reports in England that old people were being wheeled into a corner. They were deeply sedated and doctors and nurses never came near them. They had no nutrition or hydration and they died within about 2 weeks. Anyway, this got into the House of Lords in England and there was an enormous uproar over it and it was all over the newspapers and they actually banned the use of the Liverpool Protocol. And so that's now the case that you can't do that. But that's a big danger. And that's a danger under the Quebec legislation because the Quebec legislation allows that.